Today we're doing a couple of things. We are certainly celebrating the Resurrection Sunday, amen? It's an exciting day today, and I enjoy just the thought of it. Listen, I love Christmas, but there just is nothing like Resurrection Sunday, amen? I mean, it is just, I got chill bumps all over me. I don't know what time you'll get out of here today, but praise God. I don't think any of us will starve to death, amen? But I'm going to do the best I can, and I'm trying to stay focused and slow down a little bit, because I'm just... yes! Gosh! My mind is going 100 miles an hour right now. And I know that's hard for y'all to think. So this morning, we're going to celebrate not just Easter, but the Last Supper. And these two are just absolutely tied together. You can't separate the two.
That's right.
So this morning, as we prepare John chapter 13... I'm going to go to another scripture in just a moment, but I'll need you to just stay with John, okay? So John chapter 13, and it begins out like this, verse number 1. Now before the feast, that this hour, or the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was to come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the very end. Oh, friend, that's an amen waiting to happen right there. He loved us to the very end. To the very end. Now, I'm going to switch over to Mark. We've been studying the book of Mark on Wednesdays, and I just tell you, I'm so excited. This is a wonderful book. If you like action and adventure, you need to read the book of Mark. Because this book is just slam-packed full of miracles. And it is just a wonderful book for you to read. And you get so many great things in the book of Mark. But then I turn over to the book of Mark. And in chapter 14, verse 17, it says this. And in the evening he cometh with the 12. So Jesus, they are celebrating the Passover. And he brings them together for the Last Supper. And he has the 12. And there's several, a good possibility there was even more that were even present at the supper, but he focuses on the 12 in the Gospels. So he says, in the evening he cometh with the 12. And they sat down and did eat. They sat down to do the supper. And he said, verily I say unto you, one unto you, oh my goodness, one of you which eateth with me shall betray me. So we know that there's going to be a betrayal. We know that Jesus has prophesied this in the book of Mark 3 times prior to this very event. On the stage we have 12. These are the picture of the 12 disciples, and I'll let you all decide who's who. Actually, I'm going to tell you here in just a minute, alright? So the evening comes and he gathers with the 12. You know, since I'm a king and a prince, according to the word of God, I'm going to be Jesus, all right? These are the disciples or the apostles, the 12. And he gathers them up. He says, one of you are going to betray me. Now, they begin talking. Woo, they're looking at each other. And they're saying, oh, who is it? And you know that they're starting to ask questions because they wondered the whole time. Every time they would talk, it would be a lot of the conversation was, who is the greatest? So now Jesus has said, one of you are going to betray me. I bet it might be Thomas, because he doubts everything. I'm not real sure, but I bet it was Matthew, because once a tax collector, always a thief. Y'all thought I was going to say tax collector, didn't you? Okay, maybe it is Peter. My favorite. So maybe it's Peter. Maybe it's Andrew, such a humble, or Bartholomew, the one who was such an uplifter and an encourager. Maybe it is James and John, the sons of thunder that have the temper and have called down the wrath upon the cities. Maybe it's James and John. I don't know. Come with me, hurry up. it is Philip. Or maybe it is James, the son of Alphaeus. Maybe it is Thaddeus or Simon. Or maybe it is Judas. I'll tell you just a minute. But right now, we're going to celebrate the Last Supper. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, oh, what a day it is. Boy, the adrenaline is just pumping through my veins, and Father, I can't hardly focus. So Lord, I need your help. But Father, we need your help, Holy Spirit, every day. And we're here today, and we can celebrate because there is an empty tomb. Thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for raising you. And as we clear our hearts and our minds, just for this moment, would you be with us? Help us to take a moment of reflection. Help us, Father, to look at our lives in light of your Son. In Christ's name. Amen. So, if you would. simple, but it is who Mark was, who he is. He's very direct, he's very straightforward. It says in verse 22, and as they did eat, Jesus took the bread and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body. This time I'd like to ask Ethan, if you could, to just take a moment and pray for you, brother, after you get that swallowed or chewed up. He took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it, and he said unto them, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for me. Now, in the day, right down below, you write in the little thing in the seat in front before you, will be a round circle, that's for your cup, so you don't get to be playing with them if we don't get them put up. Well, the adults will be playing with them if we don't get them put up. That's right. Let's pray one more time, if we would. We just want to take a moment and be so thankful for the blood that you shed, the sinless, perfect blood for our sin. You paid the price that we could not. You did the things that we could not. You were that perfect, all-time sacrifice. And this morning, not only do we remember, but we are thankful. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. In Christ's name. Amen. Now we're going to back to the book of John. And as we go back to John, and we will begin the ceremony, continue on with John chapter 13, verse 2, and we'll kind of move forward from there. Now it says, and supper being ended, the devil, having now been put into the heart of Judas Iscariot. So at this point, the spirit of Satan has come into Judas. Where'd he go? We got to give him a minute to get back down here so we can make sure he's good to go, all right? So he's got to shut everything off over here, or I'll be walking around whistling at you, all right? So at the supper was ended, Judas Iscariot had come in, the devil had come into Judas, and verse 3, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand, and that he was coming from God and went to God, he rises up from the supper, and he laid aside his garments, and he took a towel and girded himself. And after he poureth the water into the basin, he began to wash the feet of his disciples. Now imagine this picture as the 12 disciples are here. The spirit of Satan has already entered into Judas. And Jesus decides, he says, I'm going to get down here and I'm going to take the water. I didn't grab me a big towel. I like to improvise. I'd ask one of y'all, but you'd give me one that was used. So he takes the water and he takes the towel and he begins going around. And as he washes them up, and then I'm surprised they ain't all got the shoes off already. Amen. So And he begins to wash their feet. And he takes a moment, you know, and Christ would actually get down upon his knees and he would dip his hands into it. He's washing the dirt, the sand from the week. From that week of discipling and ministering, and just that day, listen, there was not hard top roads and concrete. When they moved from place to place in sandals, their feet were dirty. So this was, you know, a common practice. When I was growing up, you did not walk in the house with your shoes on in my mama's house, all right? How many of you was like that? Yeah. You hit the door, shoes come off. Listen, I grew up in West Virginia. We had everything from head to toe, mud, and I was in the pig pen. I was feeding chickens or chasing the cow or just running, all right? So when you walked in the door, your boots come off, man. There was nothing running through the house. Mom didn't get that in the house. So when you come into a house, you would take your shoes off because your feet are dirty and your shoes are dirty. But they come in and they sit down. Jesus takes his towel and he goes around from person to person and he's washing their feet and he's drying their feet and he goes from one to the other and to the other. Then he gets to Peter. God bless old Peter, amen. Peter didn't say anything. Or well, nobody else said anything. Jesus gets to Peter and Peter says, "You washing my Lord, And the Lord says to Peter, he just gives him the nod, "Yes, I'm going to, I know you don't understand, but you will understand very soon." And Peter looks at him and says, I thought you was ahead of me already. He looked at him and said, "Lord, you ain't washing my feet." He said, "I'm sorry. I don't deserve this." And Jesus says to Peter, "If I don't wash your feet, you will not be with me." And Peter looks back at Christ and he said, "Lord, don't just wash my feet, but wash my head, my hands. Lord, I want my whole body.
Amen.
I want to be with you." So they're in this, they're going through the supper. The supper's over. He's washing their feet. I mean, this is a tremendous show of servanthood from Christ. And it's a tremendous show that the king had come to be the servant. So here they were, and what great love what Jesus was showing him. And it's such a powerful object lesson of how it is with Jesus and how great the love Jesus is. And he literally stripped himself of all his glory of heaven and he came down to earth as a servant and he was showing the men he loved the most. But on top of all of that, on top of all of the love that he had showed as a servant, he had just washed the feet of the man who would betray him. I'm going to tell you, last week I sat in a Seder meal and they brought up Jesus. And the fact of everything that was going on, I had honestly lost sight of the fact that Jesus was a servant to the man who would soon turn him over to the Romans. My friends, I know that we are to be imitators of Christ. I don't know that I could do that. I don't know that I could probably pray for my enemy that was soon to give me up, but I don't know that I could be a servant to him. I think I could heap some coals of kindness upon him, or I could stay away from him and so that there's peace kept within, and I could try to avoid confrontation, but to literally present myself as a servant to the man who is going to, literally, my assassin. Jesus presented himself as a servant to the very assassin. And as much as I want to live for Christ, I don't know that I could do that. Because conventional wisdom, it comes to us and it just says for us, listen, you got to do unto others before they do it to you. That's not how the Bible teaches, but that's what the world teaches. Common sense says, listen, you got to be proactive. I got to talk to Judas and talk him out of this thing and take care of it. You know, so you have the two senses there, but then you get to the old hillbilly sense. The hillbilly sense says, make sure you don't get out of the room alive. Let's take care of this right now. But not Jesus. Not only did he lay down his life for you and for me, but he laid down his life for the man that was going to betray. If Judas would have recognized him as Lord, Jesus would have saved him. Friend, don't tell me that God can't save you. Don't tell me that you've done too many bad things. Friend, that ain't the truth. There ain't no sin the blood of Jesus doesn't cover. Amen? There's no sin. So we know he became Judas' servant. He lost his feet. Now let's flip the script for just a moment. Have we been some type of Judas to the people around us? We're quick to judge Judas, but is that us? Have we gone out of our way? Has someone gone out of their way to be Christ to us? Or have we gone out of our way to be Christ to others? Have we turned a deaf ear to someone who is needing to see? Have we turned a blind eye to the person who needs you the very, very most? Have we betrayed someone for our very own gain? Whose character have we assassinated over the week and talked behind their back? Or have we been pretending to be close enough to someone so that we can just stab them in the back at the very last moment? Have we been a Judas to those around us? In effect, we're, you know, what I hope to see is that we ask ourselves and take a minute to ask yourself, could you wash the feet of your Judas? Could you look your enemy in the eye and say, I am here to help you. What do you need? Could you be the Jesus to the one that has hurt you the most? Or we become so concerned about the injustices that happen to us that we forget about all of those around us. We're so concerned about me and I, and we forget that we are all sinners saved by grace. We were all lost and in search one day. We were all deaf and we were all blind and could not see. We were all fallen beings who are searching for the very righteousness of God. And we are in need of this righteousness to be imputed to our very souls and to our very selves. And woe to us who spend more time praying on each other than praying for each other. In the church, it's become just like the world. And shame on us.
Amen.
We ought to be ashamed, friend. People ought to come into the house of God and know there's a difference in those people.
Amen.
They should see God in you and they should see God in me. And we need to not be part of the problem and be part of the solution. We need to, can you imagine, woe to us who have allowed Satan more space in our hearts than God. The world has led us astray, has led us astray. Now let's talk about the rest of the story. Jesus sopped his bread into the wine. And he told them, the man who I give this sop to is the man who will betray me. All of his brothers, the men he'd served with all this time, he was right beside him. And Jesus walked up and he gave the sop to Judas. And he looked at Judas and he said, whatever you're going to do, do it quickly. And Judas left the room. literally. That's how he betrayed him, amen. Judas walked out of that upper room that day, and Judas literally made a deal with the devil. I'm telling you the truth. Mike, I just want you to know I didn't come up with that.
You had to pick the craziest one.
I tell you. Now I'm gonna fast forward pretty quick. I'm not gonna hit every event, but I'm gonna hit some highlights because this is not Betrayal Sunday, this is Resurrection Sunday, amen? The story didn't stop there. See, we get to fast forward the story, and yes, Judas betrayed Jesus in the garden with a kiss, and Jesus was hauled off, and he was taken to Pilate, and after a series of events, Pilate tried, and he said, "I find no fault." Gentlemen, y'all want to go sit down, you want to stay up here? You fine? Okay. He said, "I find no fault." And this man, he was trying. He wanted them to let Jesus go. And they refused and they kept crying, "Listen, we want something to happen. We want this man to be punished for what he has done and the betrayals and the lies that they had made up, literally." And then it became the opportunity in which they could release Jesus. But no, he didn't release him. They said, "Give us Barabbas. We want someone else." So they demanded it, and Jesus went back and he was beaten and he was scourged. The Bible said that he was beaten beyond recognition of a man. It was so bad, it was unimaginable. And this crown of thorns was placed upon his head and this purple robe, and they said, "Here's the king of the Jews," and he was spit upon, and literally his beard was ripped from his face. He carried the cross to Mount Calvary, but until he just literally broke down and had nothing left, and the cross was picking up, and it was taken up to Mount Calvary, and he was nailed to that old rugged cross. It was from his stripes we were healed. It was his sinless, perfect blood that was shed upon that cross that day that paid the price for your sin and for mine. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. And he paid that wonderful price. He suffered a sinner's death. They placed him in a borrowed tomb. And on the third day, as had been predicted from the Old Testament, and on the third day, as Jesus had told them over and over and over, "I'm going to rise again." On the third day, God rolled the tomb out of the way, not so Jesus could walk out, so we could see in. And he was alive, alive, alive.
Woo!
That's our Lord. Third day, the old song, you know the song, church, "Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph over his foes. He arose a victor in the dark domains. He lives forever for the saints he arraigned." Say it with me, church. He arose. He arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose. Oh, what a beautiful song. What a beautiful time. What a beautiful time in Scripture. But do we truly understand what that means? Can you apply it to your everyday life? What does this mean? The fact that he overcome the grave, the fact that he overcome death and hell, and he overcome sin and Satan. It means this, and this is the most important thing for you to understand, church. And he arose out of the grave. When God raised him from the dead, he gives you the ability to have forgiveness for your sin.
No way.
You couldn't do that before.
Amen.
It was based upon the sacrifices. It was based upon the shed blood. He was the perfect sinless sacrifice that shed perfect sinless blood. And from that day forward, your sins can be forgiven.
Amen.
Woo, that's good stuff, amen. That's shouting crown. It means that as Christians, you have a purpose in life. You have a purpose. You are to go and to teach and to train and to sin and to witness and to be Christ so that people can see. We have purpose. We have a wonderful, wonderful, wonder-working power.
Amen.
Through the Holy Spirit of God. Jesus said, I have to go so that the Comforter may come. Amen? I have to go so that you can understand the power in which can indwell you. I want to go so that, you know, that good old power. P-O-W-A. Amen. We were singing about it a minute ago. Power. Power. Wonder-working power that comes with the very the Holy Spirit that indwells you, that comes from the very Spirit of God that is with you day by day. We are no longer bound to sin and Satan because Jesus overcome the grave.
Amen.
See, it makes the difference in the world. When Jesus come out of that grave, He changed it all. Amen.
Amen.
He changed everything. Everything was to ever happen. Everything that would go on. The fear of death is gone. Woo! I don't have to be afraid of tomorrow. Nope. I don't have to be afraid of tonight. I don't have to be afraid if I have a heart attack while I'm preaching. Because if I do, I'll get to walk through the gates of glory and say, Lord, I may not have been perfect, and I'm not perfect, but I give it everything I have.
That's right.
Friend, that's what He's asking for. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be great, because our Jesus was.
Amen.
Listen, our Jesus is great. There are no fear of death. That fear is gone because He overcome the grave. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? And the sting of death is sin, and the strength of the sin is the law. But thanks be to God. Thanks be to God, which giveth us the glory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And because He lives, you live as well.
Woo.
That's the difference the empty tomb makes. For the child of God. It makes all the difference in the world. It makes all the difference in the world. Our future is secure. All because there's an empty tomb. I read a story this week. It's a wonderful story. There's a pastor by the name of Bill Wilson. At a church in downtown New York City. Rough area. Whew, is it hot in here or what? Sweating like a vegan at the wood grill, amen. So, if you're a vegan, I'm just kidding. Right, if you watch him on Facebook, I love vegans too, all right? I just don't understand it. Right. So anyway, let me get back to the story. Bill Wilson. Pastor downtown New York City. Literally, the pastor had been stabbed twice trying to minister to the people of his community. So, as he is ministering, a Puerto Rican woman comes to know the Lord Jesus Christ. She could barely speak English. I mean, it was very limited English. So, but she wanted to help and to be a part. And she said, Pastor, you know, with an interpreter and help, what can I do for the kingdom? And he said, well, what are your gifts? What are your talents? And the woman said, I don't think I have any talent, but I love kids. And the pastor said, you know what? I'm going to put you on a bus ministry. And that little Puerto Rican woman, every Sunday morning, she would get onto a bus and she would ride into the worst parts of New York City and they would pick up children. And every Sunday, that little woman would find the little dirtiest, meanest little child, whatever the case may be, and she would put him on her lap, and she would speak the only clear sentence that she knew, I love you, and Jesus loves you.
Amen.
Months had went by. True story. Months goes by, and she continues to put that little boy on her knee. She assures him that she loved him, I love you, and Jesus loves you. And for months, that little boy never spoke a word. Never spoke at church. Never spoke on the bus. Never said a thing. One morning, she picked him up and she set him on her lap. She told him again, I love you, and Jesus loves you. The little boy never said anything. He went to Sunday school. On his way home, he's getting ready to get off of the bus. And she said one more time, I love you, and Jesus loves you. And that little boy turned to her, and he stammered with his speaking, and he said, I love you too. And he gave that little Puerto Rican woman a hug. That was at 2:30 when they dropped him off. At 6:30 that evening, she was notified that that little boy had been beaten to death by his mom. I know this is a bad story. Let's think a minute. One of the last things that little boy ever heard was, I love you and Jesus loves you. Easter service 2019. I want you to remember one thing. I love you, church, with all of my heart, but I can't love you like Jesus does. I love you. I'm here to tell you, I don't care who you are or where you are, Jesus loves you too. Let's pray.